All right, continuing our Pali class, today we're looking at Pali Primer chapters 11 and 12. Did everyone do their homework?
Mm-hmm. I've read in chapter 12.
Okay.
Wait, let me see.
You did at least half your homework. That's good. Bonus points. So, chapters 11 and 12 are expanding our perspective on verbs. Chapter 11 introduces the concept of the present participle. So present participle is built off of verb base and adds a suffix, and the two suffixes that are introduced in Pali Primer are nta, so like pachanta, and mana, so like pachamana. The two examples, pachanta and pachamana, so both from the root pach. And for completeness sake, I also mentioned the three other main present participle suffixes that you'll see in actual context, because they're all very closely related. So these four forms, so ana, ana, mana, and mana, these are all extremely similar. And in some grammatical texts, you'll see that all four of those summarized with this single statement. Can everyone read that clearly?
Mm-hmm. What's the symbol above the A?
The symbol above the A is...
Is that like a V?
Let's see if I can zoom in. Oops. The symbol above the A is a U shape, which indicates that the vowel can be either long or short. So what that's saying is that it could be mana or mana. That's what that little line above the A means. The little, like, U shape above the A. There's a fancy word for that, which I don't remember. So, and then the M in parentheses means the M may or may not be present. So, this notation is simply a condensed way of saying all of these four possibilities. So that's admittedly going beyond what's actually included in this chapter. So I'm mentioning that so that you'll more easily recognize present participles. So in previous classes, I've pointed out a few common nouns, common Pali words, which are in fact present participles, like dana. Dana is a present participle. And if you only think of these as present participle suffixes, you would never recognize dana, because dana is actually using one of these two. So dana, as I pointed out before, is from the root da, which means give, plus the suffix ana, which is that ing suffix, to give us dana, giving. So again, the present participle indicates the current ongoing action. So the English equivalent is the suffix ing. So you can basically look at these suffixes as being ing. And that makes it very simple. There's even a slight similarity. So you'll notice a slight similarity between ana and ing. And not a huge similarity, but you can notice a slight similarity. There's both three letters, they both have an N in the middle. Anyway. But that's how you recognize it. And then the other form, dash NTA suffix, again, it's used exactly the same way. It has the same meaning of ing. It's like doing is the classic example. So, and what makes present participles particularly notable as opposed to other verbs is that the present participle is declined exactly the same as a noun or an adjective, and in fact is commonly used as one. So if you see pachamana, it will be declined as any other noun that ends in A. So you might see pachamano, pachamanena, pachamanesu, or any other form that we've already encountered. So it's declined exactly the same way as any other noun or adjective. So you would look at something like pachamanena, and usually the first thing you're looking at is the suffix. So we see ana as the suffix, and we recognize the suffix as the instrumental. You see the root pach, which we know is the root to cook or cooking. And then in the middle we have amana. So this is, properly speaking, it's amana, but the A is elided for reasons that I won't go into right now. So then we recognize that this is the same as the present participle suffix. So I don't know if this was discussed earlier on, but when forming verbs, you start with the verb root, and then there's added a, I forget the exact term, like a conjugation vowel. I forget what grammarians call it, but there's a vowel that's included before you start adding on the suffix. And usually the vowel is just an A. So like pachati, or pachmana, this is a vowel that's included in order to keep things clear and simple, in order to keep consonants separate, so that things don't start to get awkward and hard to pronounce. Any questions so far?
So how would...
Please go ahead, Sarah.
How would you translate that? With cooking?
With someone who is cooking. So
pachamana
as an adjective means cooking.
Mm-hmm.
As a noun, it means one who is cooking.
Mm-hmm.
Like a person who is cooking.
Okay.
Okay? So pachamanena could mean by someone who is cooking, or with someone who is cooking.
Mm-hmm.
And so often you would see that as part of a longer statement, like pachamanena purasena, with a person who is cooking, quite literally. Or pachamanena dharakena, with a child who is cooking.
With a child who is cooking?
Yeah, or like with a cooking child.
So one word can actually be cooking.
Should be understood with a child who is cooking. What's that?
I was saying one word could actually be another sentence.
So
like a whole sentence.
Pacha.
Like
so pachamana just means cooking. But if that's being used as a noun, if it's being used as an adjective, then it'll still just mean cooking.
Okay.
So like pachamana dharaka just means the child who is cooking, the cooking child. Or let me pick a different word. Sayana, sleeping. Sayana dharaka, the sleeping child. Okay. Are we all on board?
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, it's just being used very simply as an adjective.
How would you form the present tense sentence, like the child is sleeping?
The child is sleeping. Again, I'm not used to thinking in terms of creating sentences. I'm used to thinking in terms of reading sentences.
Well, I guess my question is, when I was learning French, my
mm-hmm.
French teacher made it very clear that English has three present tenses. So, is doing, does something, and, is cooking, does cook, and he cooks, being three different present tenses. So, in a language that only has one present tense, you would have the ability, as a translator, to translate that into English in any of those three ways. Do you have that flexibility when translating Pali?
No.
Why?
So if you wanted to use the sense cooking, then you would have to use the present participle form. If you wanted to use the sense cooks, then you would use the present tense indicative form. So it's distinctly different. Dharako pachati, the child cooks. But if you wanted to say the child is cooking, it would have to be pachamano dharako. The child is cooking.
Okay, so that's how you would form that sentence.
And it's not a sentence then, it's a fragment. But the there's the implied verb to be, and I think we get to that later in the book. But anytime you have something like this, in English we'd call that a sentence fragment or a phrase, because there's no verb. But in Pali, anytime you're lacking a verb, there's immediately implied the verb to be. So it's saying, so hoti means he is or she is or it is. So the child, the cooking child is. There is a cooking child.
So do you see that that form in the texts? Like the present participle, subject, to be?
Oh gosh, do you see that in the texts? I mean, this is such an extremely simplistic statement, or sentence, that I doubt you would see it in the texts. Off the top of my head, I would be surprised. Any other questions on present participles?
I have a general question on declensions. What is the verb and the noun? So, is it just the present participle where the present participle verb decline was the noun that it goes with?
Adjectives always are declined the same as the noun they go with. Always. So, and in fact, in Pali, we don't make any distinction between an adjective and a noun. So an adjective is a noun, a noun is an adjective. They're exactly the same, they're treated exactly the same. So if we have a sentence like, the long, black, fuzzy cat. Long, black, fuzzy, and cat would all be declined exactly the same. Digena, kalena, I don't know what fuzzy is in Pali. Probably lomena. So digena, kalena, lomena, belarena. Every single one is declined exactly the same. And that's how you know what the adjectives are referring to. You look at a sentence and you look, well, what words in this sentence all have exactly the same declension? And you know that every word in the sentence that has the same declension is referring to the same thing. And again, this is important because in Pali, word order is often not what you expect in English. In fact, word order is often scrambled around in ways that is seemingly irrational, because word order doesn't matter. You just look. Like, if there's four different words in a sentence that are all instrumental singular, then they're all talking about the same thing, most likely. Doesn't matter where they are in the sentence. There are some exceptions to this, but we'll handle that when we come to it. Generally speaking, every word in the sentence that has the same declension is talking about the same thing. It's all adjectives describing the same thing. So when looking at Pali, I often don't even think of it in terms of nouns. I just think of it as they're all adjectives describing a thing. So even like Dharaka is not an adjective. It's not a noun, it's an adjective. An adjective meaning childlike, or child, having the characteristic of a child. So then you're just seeing a string of adjectives all clarifying the same thing.
Like sama, sambuddha, kaliko, basiko.
Yeah, exactly. They're all declined the same, therefore it's all talking about the same thing. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, present participle.
Could you also form the word dana with the other endings? Like, could you say dana?
I can't say I've ever seen that.
Okay.
So, what you do sometimes encounter in some Pali grammar books is theoretical grammatical forms which don't actually appear in the texts. And personally, I find this quite disingenuous. I think I find it quite bad practice, because then you wind up learning all these grammatical forms that you will never see anywhere except in grammar books. So there are theoretically other ways of forming the present participle giving from the root da, but realistically you'll just see dana. It's theoretically possible to see other forms, but I can't think of any off the top of my head. Yeah. If we encounter them, then we'll point them out. But I don't recall seeing any. Any other questions on present participle?
We're gonna do some sentences, right?
Yes, we are. After I talk about chapter 12, then we'll go through some sentences. Okay? Ready to move on?
Mm-hmm.
Ready to move on? Move on? Okay, oblivious blank stares in the back. Okay, I'll just skip the two blank stare people. Ready to move on? Okay. No offense, I love you guys. Then up until now we've only been speaking about third person verbs, so indicative third person verbs, the singular and plural tenses, so the endings T and NT. With chapter 12, we're finally given the full set of first, second, and third person verbs. So ways I like to remember this, so first person singular ends with me, because it's me who's doing it. Easy, isn't it? To give some examples, we already covered pachati. We're familiar with that. Pachati is it cooks, so third person. Well, pachami is I cook. It's me who's doing the cooking, which is why it ends with me. Pachami doing the cooking. Similarly, with the plural case, pachama. Now, that's a bit harder to directly relate, except we know that it's me, and it's not first person, so therefore, it's not singular, therefore it must be plural. So there's no simple way to remember that one. But the fact that it has the same M in it reminds you it's me, but it's just all of me's. All us me's.
Wait, what does that mean, all of me's? Us?
So we or
oh,
us.
Oh, we.
You wouldn't know it, but she's been studying English since she was 5 years old. Okay, good times.
That would be deep in Bali for the next 20 years.
Yeah, exactly.
I was just thinking about it like a Buddhist thing of performing.
The 3,000 mantras in a single moment.
So
are all perfect.
Parallel realities. Why do you call them different multi-dimensional?
Multiverse.
The multiverse.
So we're currently in the conventional world, using conventional truth to understand language. I'm happy that all this high-minded Buddhist philosophy is sinking in, though. So next we have second person, which is you do. Or you cook, in this case, pachasi, you cook. And a way to remember this, pachasi is the second person. It has the S in it, so it's second person. Pachasi, second person. Okay?
Yes.
It's good to have these little tricks. See, it's funny and you laugh, which means then you form an emotional connection with it, which means you remember. So pachami, who's doing the cooking? Me is doing the cooking. Pachami. Pachasi, it's second person because it's you doing the cooking. Got it? All right. Pachata is all of you cook. I don't have an easy way to remember that one. Any suggestions? Pachata, all of you cook. All of you do. No, that doesn't help with remembering this declension. Fired. You lose.
Okay. Die.
Thanks for trying.
Die.
Die.
Like die. Like
thine.
The old English word.
Thine.
Die.
Thine.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's. If it works, go for it. Yeah.
Does Pali do the same thing that more modern language, like Romance languages, do where the second person plural is more formal, so you could refer to a single person in a formal case?
Yes, yes, that is used in Pali. So plural is a formal or polite form that's used, even referring to a single person. And when you're being really formal and polite, you use the third person.
Hmm.
So instead of saying like, you go get me some water, you would say something like, the man in white gets me some water. Or like, it would be good if the man in white brought water. You see this in the suttas, like people won't go to the Buddha and say like, hey Buddha, teach us. They would be like, it would be good if the Buddha would teach us some things. And then the Buddha's like, well, but I'm going to my dwelling now. And then Mahakachana gives the teaching instead or something, which happens from time to time. But more frequently, the Buddha then would go ahead and teach himself. He himself would teach. Again, we're getting into a little multiverse thing. So he teaches the other manifestations of the Buddha mind. So literally he is teaching himself, but the other himself doesn't know that they're also himself. But this is, again, veering beyond the subject of what we're talking about here. So, Pachati and Pachanti, these are third person. So, it cooks, or he, she cooks. Again, I don't have an easy
tea
way to...
is it backwards.
That's true. You could also take the T as that, like that person cooks. Nti, just there's more letters, so it's more people. That's all I got. Is that what? So that's the basic form. So pachami, I cook. Pachama, we cook. Pachasi, you cook. Pachata, all of you cook. Pachati, it cooks. Pachanti, they cook. All right?
It cook.
What?
It cook.
It cooks.
How can it cook?
Because it cooks. It goes in the kitchen and it cooks.
That's impossible.
Why?
Are you referring to a person? It
cooks. Well, it's a gender neutral singular pronoun.
Oh, like he, she. Okay.
So I know that these days it started to become popular to use they as a singular pronoun. But for the sake of clarity here, in order to distinguish singular pronoun from plural pronoun, I'm using it. Otherwise, we would have they does and they do, which is not proper English. So it does and they do. Are we all on board?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So again, I have nothing wrong with people referring to themselves as they. It's totally fine. But for the sake of learning grammar, it's important to clearly distinguish between singular and plural. So that's why I use the word it in this case. Any clarification wished for on this? Okay, ready to move on? Okay, so let's have a look at some examples where all things become clear, hopefully. So, we'll do this the same way we've been doing things all along. So, mayang punyang ichanta samananang danang dadama. Who wants to start telling me some words? So if you recognize any word in the sentence, go ahead and tell me what you think it means.
Danam.
What does danam mean? What does it mean? Come on.
Well, I know the root, giving, but I don't remember danam.
Okay, we'll go with that, giving. Great. What's the declension?
Yeah, I don't remember that.
Accusative.
Accusative.
Plural.
Try again.
Singular.
Okay.
Yeah, that one.
Okay, accusative singular. Great. So we'll translate this more simply as gift. So any other words in the sentence that are recognizable?
We.
First word, we. Excellent. Any other words that are recognizable? Samanana, what do you think that means?
Monks?
Contemplatives? Yeah, so, and what's the declension?
Anam,
correct, and what's the declension? What does anam mean? What's that suffix mean?
Locative?
No.
Ablative?
Keep guessing.
By means of?
If
no.
You just list all eight of them, then eventually you'll get it right.
For the monks.
For is one possibility. What's another possibility?
Another possibility.
What else?
to.
No.
Off the most, the origin?
Of, yes.
Right.
For or of. So what's the technical word for these?
Genitive and
genitive
dative.
Is one? Dative. Excellent. Okay. What other words in the sentence can we recognize?
Ishanta is wish.
What's the form?
To wish? No, that's...
we just learned this.
Wishing.
Correct.
Wishing.
And what's the declension? Because remember, present participles are declined.
So this is declined in the plural
nominative.
Plural nominative, great. And what else in the sentence is also plural nominative?
We.
Correct. All right, so we have two more words in the sentence to translate. Punyang, this should be a familiar word.
Song?
What?
Guessing.
Merit.
Yes! Excellent. And what's the declension?
It is accusative.
Accusative what?
Singular.
Great. One word left to translate. This should not be difficult. The Dhamma. Give? Correct. The root is give. What's the declension?
We give, like a plural thing.
Excellent. We give. Okay, so let's go ahead and put this all together. Somebody want to tell me what they think the sentence means?
We give a gift for the contemplatives wishing for merit.
Close, but slightly off. What's off here? So, wishing is in the same declension as we.
We give a gift to the contemplatives.
Perfect. So again, we is plural nominative and wishing is plural nominative. So it's we who are wishing. The way she translated it is just right. Wishing for merit or wishing to have merit, we give a gift to the contemplatives, for the contemplatives. Okay? Any questions on that? Somebody looks really confused. Okay.
I have a question, actually.
Yes.
So for the accusatives, it doesn't need to be like, we give merits, like it doesn't need to be related to the verb that we would think of as like the main verb of the sentence. I don't know if I'm making sense. Am I making sense?
Oh, well, there's two accusatives here. So the first accusative is the object of the present participle.
And how would we know that?
Well, the location is an indication. So Punyang Ichanta, so wishing for merit. So the location here, again, I mentioned location and sentence does make a difference in some cases. This is an example. So it's we who are wishing for merit, who give a gift for the contemplatives. So this accusative comes before this verb. Therefore, we can assume that these are connected, that it's a single phrase. We, the ones who are wishing for merit, give a gift. So this accusative comes with this verb. So we can assume that this is one phrase. These are connected. So we give a gift. Okay? All set?
All set.
Great. Any other questions before we move on? All right. Let's have a look at another sentence. Do you prefer doing it random word call out or doing it from start to end of the sentence?
Random.
Okay, so we need a tiebreaker vote.
I don't care that much. I don't care that much either.
Do you care that much?
Well, let's just identify the words.
Okay, well, let's identify some words.
With the chariot.
With the chariot, great. Cool, what else is going on here?
Goes.
Going is
with
going.
The plural
going.
With going,
plural, excellent.
With the ministers.
Let's also give some other people a chance to answer. As happy as I am at your developing skill. So, who else would like to indicate the meaning of some words?
Saha means with.
Correct. How about acharyo? I'll give you a hint, I'm one.
Monk?
No. Though, yes, I mean I am, but that's not what it's not what the word means.
Wise? Old?
I'm one of those. It's true, I'm old.
Male?
No.
Why?
Okay,
teacher?
Let's make this simpler. Teacher?
Teacher.
Teacher, correct. Acharya means teacher. Because it's a very commonly used loan word in many Buddhist countries.
Actually, knew that word.
Also, you see it, ajahn. The Thai word ajahn is a
derivative
of acharya. So, fun fact though, the word acharya literally means assailant, like someone who attacks you.
That is a fun fact.
Yeah.
Good times.
It makes sense.
So it totally changes. It's like, can you see Ajahn Chah?
The attacker Cha.
Okay, so.
Nominative.
Teacher, nominative. Good nominative, what?
Singular.
Singular, correct. Teacher, Hasati. What's Hasati?
Gives?
We were all doing it just a moment ago.
Oh,
laughs. Eat.
Laughs.
Oh.
Excellent.
Oh.
That's funny. I think you've been in it for too long.
Pretty inside. Okay, so let's put this all together. What's going on here?
The teacher laughs with the ministers going with the chariot.
Okay, you've got the right general idea, but let's make it a little more fluid.
The teacher laughs with the ministers who are going by a chariot.
Excellent. Much better.
Wait, so who are going by a chariot?
The ministers.
The ministers are going in a chariot.
But not the teacher.
And the teacher is laughing with them. The sentence does not make it clear whether or not the teacher is also in the chariot.
Well, because he's attacking them.
Okay, moving on. Rukamule sayantasa yachikasa kaye panani patanti. Correct, yeah, ruka. Ruka is tree, mula is root. And what's the declension?
Accusative plural.
Tree root or tree base. It could be accusative plural, what else could it be?
It could also be locative singular.
Could be locative singular, which
Probably is.
We'll keep in mind the other possibility and play with it later and see if it works. Probably not, but we'll try. Sayantasa. Sayantasa. Someone.
Sleep? No. Eyes?
Yes, good. You're off to a good start. The root is sleep. What's the form?
That's the...
genitive. It could be the genitive, or it could be dative.
Correct. That's the declension. But there's one more piece to this.
It's a present participle.
Correct. So, saya nta asa. So, sleeping, genitive dative. So, of or for the one who is sleeping. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay, yachikasa.
Begging?
Close. You spotted the root correctly, but
bag,
it's not begging.
Well, it's genitive or dative, so it's...
Correct.
Off for baggers?
Close.
Baggers.
Bags?
You were closer before.
Baggers?
So is it singular or is it plural?
Oh, that singular.
Yes. One beggar. Okay, let's keep going. Kaye. Kaye, come on.
Locative?
I'll give you a hint. We all have one.
Body.
Yes. What's the declension?
It is the plural accusative.
Or it could
or
be
locative.
Singular.
Locative singular. We'll go with that. I'm going to suggest that's probably what it is. But we'll explore the other possibility. Once we're done.
I'm gonna make you suggest it.
Okay. Fine. Always a chance to practice patience. So, panani. This is not panini,
neuter.
But panani.
Neuter.
Yeah. Neuter. Yes, correct. It is in fact a neuter noun.
Plural.
Plural neuter noun, good.
Leaf,
correct. So what's the declension? We know it's a neuter plural noun, and we know it's a leaf, so leaves. What's going on with those leaves?
They're picante.
And what case would that make it? If the
nominative.
Leaves are... Yes. Great. So, and what is picante? Falls, yes.
They fall.
Okay, so let's put this all together. Anyone want to take a stab at what the sentence means?
The leaves fall at the tree base onto the body. Onto the body of the sleeping beggar?
You're getting close. That's slightly off. Tree base is out of place.
Oh, the leaves falls on the body of the beggar sleeping at the tree base.
Correct. Excellent. You just earned another scoop of ice cream.
What about my red star?
We no longer give out red stars. This is a capitalist country. So, moving on. For those watching from China, no offense was intended. Pasanas meng tatva tong chandang pasitong osahasi. Lots of fun going on here. Thoughts?
Stone.
Great. Stone. What's the declension?
I'm one of them.
That is correct.
Locative singular?
Yes.
Tuong is you.
Correct.
Right?
Tuong is you.
And that's having...
Having
something.
What? Having something. Great.
Mm-hmm.
You recognize the form.
Plural?
No.
Having.
It's irregular, right?
No, it's actually quite regular.
Oh, it's fine.
Nothing flawed here at all. But it's something that, anyway, that gets into a more complicated issue.
Oh,
suffice to say, it doesn't look exactly the same as the verb form that we're used to seeing.
Having stood or stayed?
Yes.
What's the normal form that we're used to seeing?
The form that we're used to seeing is tip-tati.
Oh.
Which the root is still ta, ta. But there's what's called root duplication, which is a relatively advanced topic in Pali verbs, which we won't get to anytime soon. Suffice to say that the root is ta, so saying tatva is not the least bit surprising. This is perfectly normal. So let's look at some more words. What's chandang? You think you know?
I might.
What do you think it is?
Is it moon?
Yes.
Oh,
excellent.
Oh,
that is what it is. I knew that. Not really.
Nice try. So, pasatum.
Are we not going to do a declension for the moon?
Oh, what declension do you think it is?
Single?
Probably yes. Great. So what's pasatum? You're permitted to answer.
To see?
Correct. Correct.
I'm unemployed, this is all I do.
See, that's what I like to hear. So you're half none already. I can recommend some monasteries.
Okay.
Stop thinking and just do it.
Oh, yeah?
You don't have to commit to anything right off the bat, but just go and spend a week or two in a monastery, and you'll get a sense if that's what you want to do. Yeah. It's really worth it.
Okay.
So, what's a hussy? What's this word mean?
Hoping? Or hopes?
No.
Tries.
Yes, and what's the form?
Second person.
Yes, how do you know that?
Because there's you, but also because there's the sea.
Good. You try. So what is the sentence saying? Something that Reverend has probably done while doing Kaihogyo on the mountains.
Trying to look at the moon.
Stood on the stone to try to see the moon. Let's go. What's next?
I.
Correct. The thing which doesn't exist. Next. What's Harunyang? That thing which money used to be based on.
Gold.
Yes! Back before it became arbitrarily valued pieces of paper. So, pariye santo.
Nomato? Singular?
It is nominative singular, that's correct. What else is going on here?
It's a present participle.
It's a present participle, correct. Does everybody see why it's a present participle? Does anybody not see why? Well, you don't count because you're new. No offense.
The
Exactly that.
Mm. Oh, it makes sense.
R-E-A-S-U-N-T-O. Mm-t-o. So present participle, nominative, and what's the verb?
Exploring, searching.
Searching, yeah. So searching. Deepam hi.
Singular.
Okay. What's the next one?
Pits.
Pits. And?
Probably is going to be plural accusative.
Probably plural accusative. What's the other possibility?
Locative. Singular.
So it could be pits or in,
yeah,
on, at, pit.
Probably in.
Probably, but you never know for sure until you put the whole sentence together. And what's Kanami?
What does one do to a pit?
What do you do to a pit?
Me?
Yes! Yay! I'm so happy that you're learning things. You must have been studying all night.
Thanks. So funny.
Yeah. And what's the form? What's the declension?
Kanami.
Kanami.
Yeah. Oh.
See? He got one. Yay, he got one. You gotta crawl before you can walk. Okay, so what does the sentence mean? Let's put it all together. I gold searching on Lamp Island pits or in on at a pit I dig.
Oh, so, lamp and island.
Well, the word deepa can mean either lamp or island.
So what in this term it would mean island, not lamp, right?
Most likely.
So why don't you say lamp?
Okay, so let's go ahead and take lamp out for now, even though it's fun to leave it in.
I'm crawling here.
You're crawling. Okay, I'll help you crawl a little more.
Okay.
There. Though it's kind of fun when it's on the lamp, but we can go with on the island instead.
I dig pits on the island searching for gold.
Correct. Excellent. Or it could be I dig in a pit on the island searching for gold. Or it could be I dig in a pit on the lamp searching for gold.
No, that's not making sense.
Why not?
I need to be on the lamp.
Dig pits on a lamp. Well, there might be gold buried inside the lamp. So you're digging in the lamp and get at the gold. Okay, we'll go with island, since we have a literalist in the crowd. Okay, another fun one here, and I'm willing to bet that Reverend knows at least one of the words in the sentence.
Huh?
Do you?
Bija?
Correct! What does Bija mean?
See?
Yes! See,
what does it mean?
You know more than you know. So, and this one we'll probably have to get someone else to answer. What is the declension of this word?
Plural.
Plural, neuter. Correct. Plural neuter. Plural neuter what?
Accusative or something else?
Probably accusative, but it might also be nominative. Could be vocative, though it's very unlikely.
Yes.
So nominative or accusative.
Oh,
so.
Seems.
Why won't you grow?
That is a completely feasible sentence, in fact. So, let's get some other words here. Come on, more words.
Cossico is...
What's a cossico?
It's a farmer.
Okay. Yeah, we have a plowman, aka farmer. Great. What's some other words in the sentence?
Love
him. Love him. What do you think that means?
I know what that means earlier today.
Well, let's go with something simpler. Kasiko and kasidwa. Looks like they're the same root, doesn't it?
Uh-huh.
So, then we would assume that they might have a similar meaning.
Having plowed?
Good.
Danyang is corn.
Danyang, it can mean corn, but more generally it means
grain,
or it can also mean money. I don't know if that's mentioned in the textbook here.
No, it's not. I had a question about that, because I was like, I didn't think they had corn in ancient India.
I don't know, actually. Do you know? Did they have corn in ancient India?
No.
Okay. It doesn't matter. Except as to say, danyang means grain, or sometimes money. Or sometimes wealth in a more general sense. Yeah, I don't know why it says corn in the book.
Yeah, that was very confusing.
All right.
Love it, receive.
Close. It means more like gain or acquire. And what's the form? What's that tone ending?
To gain.
Yes, to gain is the infinitive form, correct.
And on the book, though, it uses this ng, that form, that letter, not the M with a dot on top, but
oh,
the
this
N
one?
With the, yes.
Yeah, I know, I don't like that. Like the N with the tail, I don't like the N with the tail. I prefer the N with the dot.
Why don't you like the N with the tail?
Because it looks weird and it's unfamiliar. So the Pali Roman alphabet, it uses all like regular ordinary Roman letters with dots and dashes to signal the ones that are different from Roman letters. So this is why I don't like the like where they created new characters with like ends with special tails and things. I don't like that because it's not a regular Roman letter.
But it looks so pretty.
Okay, we're veering a little off subject here.
Kingham is evil.
Correct. For example, the Sangha is called the Punyaketa. The Keta of Punya. Yeah. All right, and what is Akankati? Last word in the sentence.
Oh, we haven't gotten to what.
Oh, vapanto as well, yes. Very important part of the sentence. What is vapanto?
Sowing.
Yes, and what is the declension? This shouldn't be too challenging.
Relative singular.
Correct. And one last word before we can put the sentence together, akankati. Yes, hoping or wishing.
In this case, hopes.
Hopes. Yep.
Wait, but isn't hopes like if chanting isn't that mean hopes?
Chanting means more like wishes. So we'll go with. And the two words are very similar. Akankati can also mean expects.
So it's more solid. It's like I hope instead of I wish.
Hmm. Yeah, I expect.
Yeah,
it's a little bit more like.
Yeah, it's like wishing is sort of like it might happen, but it might not, but it'd be nice if it did. Expecting is like, it's gonna happen. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, putting this all together, what do we have? Akankati, I think that can also mean waits for. or think of desire. Yeah. So, what does this sentence mean? Sarah?
I'll try. Having plowed the field, the farmer who is sowing seeds hopes to gain grain.
Perfect. Excellent.
Oh, the seed-sowing farmer.
Yep, the seed-sowing farmer. Correct. All right, great. Any questions on that sentence?
Or wealth, right?
Or wealth. Yeah, he could be hoping to gain wealth.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he might be planning. He might be planning to sell his crops for profit. Okay, let's keep pressing on here. How are we doing so far? Is anyone totally lost? Okay. Is anyone getting bored? Okay. Well, okay. Moving on. Chivarang Parye Santasa Samanasa Acharyo Chivarang Dadati.
Oh, this one. This is from a lesson.
They all work.
Really?
Yeah, I just
really?
I cherry pick sentences from the lessons.
Yeah.
I didn't do that.
You didn't pick.
Yeah. So you both just implicitly admitted that you didn't do the lessons.
No, I did a lot of them. I just didn't
do
the ones that you... They're like 30 questions.
Yeah, and they
well, yeah, I'm not expecting you to do all of them. But if you do... doing at least some of them is good.
Yeah.
But actually, if you did do all of them, then you would accumulate vocabulary much more quickly.
Yeah.
And also, you just... you accumulate vocabulary through usage.
The man having done them.
It is not learning. So, you are learning. It takes time. Learning a language takes time. There's not really any shortcut to learning a language. You just have to keep doing it. And it starts to accumulate in your mind. So you can learn grammar through abstraction and intellect to some extent.
Ropes.
Are you trying to get us back on track?
She's like, oh no, he's getting preachy again. Okay, so robe, correct. What is which word here means robe?
Chivarang and the other one.
Yes, chivarang means robe, and what is the declension?
Accusative singular.
Yes! Excellent!
Yes.
Parye santasa. We encountered another form of this word
searching.
Very recently. Searching, correct. And what's the declension?
Oh! Yeah.
Declension.
It's present participle, genitive, or dative.
Yes! And samanasa. Great. And acharyo.
Teacher.
Great. Or? Correct. They're always attacking you. Why didn't you do your homework? Okay. Chivarang, we already said, is robe. And what is dadati?
Give.
And what's the case?
Third person singular?
Yes. So let's put this all together.
The teacher gives the robe for the contemplative searching for the robe.
Okay, you've got the right general idea, but let's Let's put it in a form that makes a little more sense.
It makes sense.
Okay, right generally, yeah. But let's make it a little more fluent.
But the teacher gives the robe to the contemplative looking for...
To the contemplative who
is looking for a robe.
Correct. Okay, better. Great.
Yeah, I'll
say. Yay, she learns language. Yay. Okay. Any questions on that?
How would you say...
Questions?
How do you say for the contemplative who is looking for one?
What's that?
It's awkward to repeat robe
twice.
Well, it's quite normal in Pali to see words repeated. So, like, this didn't register to me as being at all unusual because I'm used to reading Pali where things
wow,
are...
Okay.
Yeah, it's normal to have a noun repeated multiple times in one sentence or a verb or even a whole phrase repeated over and over again in short succession. So this didn't register to me as being at all strange. In English, we would say, yeah, the teacher gives a robe to the contemplative who's looking for one. So in translation, you might actually translate it that way because it sounds more comfortable. But it's important to know what it literally means. What it literally means is to pay attention to the Pali lesson, not to the cat.
A sale.
So... Viharangupasankamanto buddho dhammang vasamane savake pasati.
Buddho
the
Buddha!
Yay! We got one word. What's the
Dhammam the Dhamma!
Yes!
Accusative singular!
What? Accusative singular? So yeah, dhammang is accusative singular. What's
Viharam?
Buddha?
Buddha is nominative singular.
Great, so let's start at the top. Viharam.
The church. The monastery, the temple, whatever.
Okay, whatever. We'll go with monastery, but what is the declension?
Accusative.
Correct, accusative what?
Singular.
Great. Upasankamanto.
Present participle.
Present participle, correct.
Nominative singular?
Nominative singular, correct. And what does it mean?
Approaching.
Yes. We can, just for the fun of it, I'm going to break this word down a little bit more. So upa means close, sung means together, and come means walk. So upa sung kamati means one walks close. Okay?
So
one goes close.
But what about together?
Yeah. Yeah, it's the same as upasaka. Upasaka is upa, close, asaka, one who sits. Yep.
But what about together?
Yeah. Good question. I don't know. Yeah, it's not clear why that particular prefix gets thrown in the middle there. So, beside the point, the Buddha. Dhamma. Vasamane. What's this word? Doesn't mean bossy. So, Vasamane. Is that bossy man? No, Vasamane. Close though. What's the bossy?
You're like living dictionary.
What is a bossy? What is a bossy person always doing?
Telling.
Close.
Speaking.
Speaking. Yay.
So discussing would be a different.
Yes, that's a different word.
Okay.
Speaking or talking about.
Savaka,
somebody know it actually? Reverend Myowe might know Savaka.
What's that?
Listener. Yes, it technically means listener.
Hearer.
Or listener or hearer, but more precisely, its connotation is disciple or student. However, what is the declension? Plural what?
Accusative.
Plural accusative, good. And what's paucity?
Sees.
Sees. Great. And what's the declension?
It.
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 Yep. Or in this case, he. So putting the sentence together. What's that?
The Buddha, while approaching the monastery, sees the disciples speaking
Dhamma.
Speaking Dhamma.
Perfect. Great.
So what does Sabaku Sango mean?
So, Savaka, this literally means listener. More fluently, we would say disciple or student. And Sangha means community. So, Savaka Sangha means the community of disciples.
Okay, Savaka Sangha. You know what I mean?
Yeah, Supatipanno Bhagavato Savaka Sangho. So Bhagavato, we'll get to this later, but it's genitive dative of Bhagava, which is one of the names of the Buddha. So that means of for Buddha. So Bhagavato Savaka Sangho means the community of disciples of the Buddha.
Cool. See, now I know what I was chanting in the past couple of weeks.
Yeah. Okay. Any other questions on this? All good? Okay. Let's do some more. If anybody starts to feel soul-crushingly depressed by this, we can call it quits at any time. Otherwise,
I wanted to hear this one because I don't know what Vista means.
Great, fun times. Well, let's start putting the sentence together. So, what's agacchantam? Does any part of this look familiar?
Gacchanti.
So, gacchanta means
goes.
And agacchanta
comes.
And what's the form?
Present participle.
Coming.
Present participle. Great.
Accusative singular?
Most likely, yep. And what do we have? Tapasam. What's this?
Not a Spanish dish.
No. There are no tapas.
Accusative singular?
Accusative singular, yes, but what is the word?
It's not like a tapas like energy or
close. Close. Ascetic. Because an ascetic was trying to produce inner heat. Tapas literally means heat. But it has that applied meaning of like spiritual energy.
Yeah, I've seen that power meaning more in like yoga people.
Yeah, but its original form is that you inflicted these burning sensations on your body because there was a belief that that would then produce spiritual heat or spiritual fire. And the Buddha was like, no. No. No good. Okay, Disva. Sunny. Nicole. Alex. Giovanna. Sarah.
It's having.
Correct. You're off to a start. It's, you got the form correct. What's the word? I'll give you a hint. It's from the same root as the word ditti.
Points out?
What's a ditti? Or you might, some people might know the Sanskrit word.
Yes.
Drishti. Do you know this one?
Like a seeing or like a quick concentration.
Seeing. Seeing is correct, exactly right. So, ditti means view, or perspective, or like how you see the world. So disva is having seen. So most commonly where we see ditti is samma ditti.
Right view.
Right view, correct.
Aww. That's why I was like, that's familiar, but I can't remember that.
So that's the easiest way to remember disva, because otherwise it's not a recognizable form, because what we're used to seeing is pasati as the verb sees. So disva doesn't appear to have any relationship to the word pasati, because it doesn't. It's from a different root, and we remember that root because it's the same root as dipti. And dipti is a very important word to be aware of in Buddhist philosophy, because it's we're trying to relinquish Miccha ditti and develop Samma ditti. And in fact, the Buddha often simply summarizes, he simply refers to Miccha ditti as just ditti. Like, a ditti is by definition wrong. Anytime you take a fixed perspective, it's by definition wrong.
Mm-hmm. So the Samma, is it, right in the sense of like an absolute right? Or?
It's more right in the sense of correct. The root it comes from is actually sam, which means peaceful.
Oh.
Hmm.
So samma literally means peaceful. Yes.
Oh,
so samma ditti is like the view that leads to peace.
Oh, cute.
So that's a completely different approach, which I actually haven't seen any teacher emphasize. But it's a very different way of looking at the word samma. But more generally, the way that samma more generally means is like correct or accurate. That's more how it's used. But yeah.
Okay, because it conduces to peace, so peace of mind and peace everywhere, like
correct.
An absolute term.
Yeah, because usually samma is used in like morally correct or morally right, which from a Buddhist term, morally right means it leads to awakening, it leads to enlightenment, which means it leads to ultimate peace, to true peace.
Mm-hmm.
So the correlation to the root piece is very, very visible. Okay?
Yeah.
And it also has sort of like that, I don't know, I like it because it's like the right view is whichever view is going to lead to peace in that moment.
Mm.
Not to get too
angry,
but anyway.
Okay.
A little diverse,
yeah. Nice.
Okay, let's have some more fun. What does so mean? Yes!
He? Did we get she? We didn't get she or it, right?
We do not have she or it. We only have he so far.
Food,
correct. Oops. Somebody other than Sarah want to answer this next one? No, it's fine. It's fine. I'm glad somebody is learning.
Received?
Close, but no.
Getting?
Close.
Eating?
Well, okay, receives and gets are close. It means take.
Oh.
So aharati means takes. So what is aharatum?
Taking.
To take.
Yes,
okay.
It's the infinitive, to take. Gehang? Okay, she knows the answer. Does anybody else know the answer? Fine, spit it out.
House or home?
House, great. And how about publicity? So when you came to the house, you...
Knock.
Enter?
Enter.
Thankfully, I know that we didn't learn that verb yet.
Well, that's because you actually studied.
But she's polite.
And what is the... what is the declension?
Third person singular.
Correct. So let's put this all together. agachang tapasang disra so batang aharatong gehong pavisiti. What does this mean?
The food entered the house today. The
seen the coming ascetic, he enters the home to take food to him.
Yeah.
Or just
yes.
Take
well,
food
to
away.
Yeah, to him is that would be implied, because Sunny also pulled out another possible meaning for this. It could be he sees the ascetic coming, so he goes in the home to take the food. We don't know why he's taking food. He might be taking the food to give it to the ascetic, but he might be taking the food to run away.
To hide it.
Or to hide it. or to eat it himself. We don't know. All we know is that he's going in the house to take the food. So be careful not to impute motive beyond what is clearly specified in the sentence. Okay? Any clarification needed on this one?
Why do you mean to... have so in there? Isn't the subject implied?
It's not needed, but it's included so that we learn the word, because you will see that word in Pali texts.
Okay.
Yeah, it's true. It's technically unnecessary.
Okay.
Technically, all of the pronouns are unnecessary. So, aham, mayam, my mind blanks. So these are all unnecessary. You don't need pronouns in Pali, but they're often included for the sake of clarity or for sentence flow or just because that was how people talked. Yeah, technically not necessary. Let's look at another one.
You?
Correct. Gehasa, this should be easy.
House.
House? What's going on with it?
Verse 4.
Great. How about dwaram? Sarah?
I don't know this one. It's accusative.
Door. Oh, great.
Door.
Hey, and accusative. Accusative of what?
Single and
great. And vivaritva.
Having.
Correct. How about paniyam?
Drinking water?
We'll just go with water. Literally it means that which is drinkable. So this is paniyam, and this is getting ahead of ourselves, but I'm going to do it anyway. Paniya is a future participle.
Ooh.
So we'll get to that fun later on. It's a future participle that means something to be drunk, something you can drink, something drinkable. But the most common way it's used is just to mean water. And what's the declension, paniyam? Probably accusative singular. What's patamha?
From.
From. Good. From what? What's a patta?
Bowl.
Yes. From bowl adaya. Do we recognize the root?
Dana, not
given. Close. So da, what's the root da?
Give.
Give. The root da is give. Prefix a.
The opposite, not give.
Take.
Oh,
take.
Take.
Good. And what's the suffix? I'm not expecting you to know.
Having done. Having taken.
Yes, excellent. And how about Tivasi?
Drink.
Correct, and what's the case?
Music.
What's that?
Music.
Second person.
Correct, yes. Tivasi, second person. Alright, so let's put this all together.
Having opened the door of the house.
Good.
You having taken.
They're playing little tricks on you. Go ahead, having taken.
Water from the bowl.
Excellent! Excellent.
Your drink.
Yes! Well done. Noticing again the trickiness of word order here. Because these words could have been in the other order, and it would have had the same meaning. So it could have been patamha paniyam instead of paniyam patamha, and it would have the same meaning. Either way you read it, having taken water from the bowl. Does that make sense?
And could you have adaya after ivaigva?
No, that would be weird.
So they always put the.
This is the normal form is with a clause or a phrase, like a clause or a phrase using the absolutive. It's the absolutive follows whatever it's referring to.
Okay.
So like this is one complete absolutive phrase. This is one complete absolutive phrase.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, great. So then that makes life really easy because then you always know whatever comes first and then it's related to that.
Yeah.
Principle.
Yeah.
Okay.
It is kind of weird to have pronouns.
Well, that's because you grew up with a language that doesn't have pronouns.
No, we don't.
You have pronouns? I thought there were no pronouns in Chinese.
Cool.
Yeah.
Ha.
Oh,
yeah.
There are pronouns in Chinese? Oh,
mm-hmm.
I stand corrected.
Yeah, it sounds the same for she and he, but there's pronouns.
You guys have gender-neutral pronouns?
No,
the character is
different,
but
it's the sound is
the same.
Oh, okay.
There's a lot of jokes about that.
Well, I was just thinking, that's so progressive. I would never have expected that.
You've got it going on.
Yeah, I'm... wow. All right, moving on.
Mm-hmm.
We're almost through here for those who are beginning to wilt under the pressure.
No, I'm getting into it, actually.
Oh, good.
Mm-hmm.
You really don't have to stay, just because your teacher told you to stay.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
It's interesting.
Okay. So, Rukesu, tree? What's going on with the tree? What's the declension? That's the suffix, and what does it mean? So, we know Rukka is tree.
At the trees.
Esu, at the trees.
Near the trees, on the trees, in the trees.
Okay, it's locative, so at, on, or in the trees. Nisidhitva.
Having,
correct. So you recognize the suffix. Tva means having. And what's the verb? It's an added layer of difficulty.
Everybody understands what sit means.
Oh yeah, I knew exactly what you meant. Okay, Palani. Palani.
Fruit?
Yes.
Fruit?
Fruit.
Fruit.
Fruit. And what's the... Fruits? Yep. Yep. And how about Bunjamana?
Kumara means
means boy. Voice.
That's correct. So let's handle Bunjamana first. Well, first off, what's the form? Bunjati means?
Something.
It has something to do with fruits. We know that much.
Climbs?
You climb the fruit?
What?
Well, it might be a gigantic fruit that you climb.
Yes.
Eat. Yes, bunj means eat. So what's mana?
So
what's the suffix mana? Eating.
Present participle, plural, nominative.
Yes, perfect. So they're not eating boys, it's the boys who are eating. And how about Geetang Gayanti? I used to know an Indian woman named Geeta. It's a relatively common name.
Is that song?
Yes. And what's the declension?
Accusative, singular.
Yes. And what's Gayanti?
Sing.
Sing. Yep. And what's that declension?
Third person.
Yeah. So let's put this all together. What do we have?
Boys sing song. Having sat on trees, the boys sing the song while eating fruits.
Correct. Yay! Cool. Okay. Samanehi basanta upasaka sachang adigantong usahanti. Lots of familiar words here. Samanehi.
Contemplative.
Great. What's going on with the contemplatives? What's the declension?
With.
With. Contemplatives. What's pasanta? We saw this word earlier. Someone who is bossy, does a lot of...
Speaking.
Speaking, good. Upasaka.
Sitting posture.
Which?
Disciple.
Disciples.
Disciples,
correct. How about sachang? Does anyone...
Truth.
Yes, very important word. Arigantum.
200, or... No, understanding.
It can mean understand, but it can mean, more literally it means to grasp, or to get, or to go to, or to reach, to attain.
Having attained?
Wrong form. What's the verb form here?
Oh, to attain.
Yes.
Sorry.
How about usahanti? Saw this verb earlier. Try. And what's the form?
They.
Yes. So, what's this say?
The disciples try to attain truth by speaking to the contemplatives.
You've
While
got the
speaking.
Excellent. So, Mayang Manusa Lokam Ha Chavitva Sage Upajitung Akang Kama. And here's the N with the tail that I don't like, so we're going to replace it with the N with the dot that I do like.
We
do not like the N with the tail. We Manusa Loka. We were just talking about this with Reverend Ryohei all weekend. What's
the people realm?
Yes. Specifically the human realm.
The human realm.
The human world. So manusa is human and loka is world.
Oh, that makes sense. Loka means crazy in Spanish.
The crazy world.
Well, except loka means world, so that means they're all crazy.
Yeah.
Which makes sense because it's all samsara.
Yeah.
Therefore, it's all crazy.
Okay.
So, but lokam ha, what's that ha suffix mean? Lokam ha, what's
from.
This? From, excellent. Chavitva, what's the declension?
Having died,
or literally means having fallen. But the applied meaning is having died.
Oh.
Well, that's important because it explains why the declension for this is from having fallen from the human world, rather than having died from the human world. We
so
don't say that.
Like passing away would be like a, that's a little loose, but in English, because it means both like passing from something and we use it as a euphemism for dying.
Yeah. You could say that. Yeah, that's a similar
thing. Thank you for humoring me.
Consider yourself humored. So, sangye.
Was?
What?
Oh.
Sangye.
Heavens.
Yes. Or, well, heaven, but what's the declension?
Accusative?
Or?
Or locative. Singular.
Neuter?
Yes. I'm going to pretend you didn't say anything.
Yes, I'm not going to say anything.
Upajatong.
To be born.
Yeah, literally it means to
born.
To appear or to arise. Where it what it comes from is the prefix ud, which means up. And pud, which means to reach. Reach up, it doesn't, the literal meaning isn't terribly useful, but what it literally means is to arrive at, or to appear in. So upajati means you appear there, or you arrive there. So when we're talking about the round of rebirth, and you can say you're born there, but technically born is jayati.
Right.
From which we get the word jati, which might be a familiar word for some people.
In the kinds of dukkha.
Yeah, jati pi dukkha. Birth is also dukkha. Okay. So upajitong, to appear. Akankama.
Expecting
or
wishing
or hoping. And what's the form? Akan kama ma.
Plural. We.
Yes. So let's put this all together. What does this mean?
Isn't it good?
Having fallen from the human world, we wish to appear in heaven.
Correct. Okay, next time we're going to have to let somebody else answer the final sentence formulation. In fact, since the final sentence formulation does not require either vocabulary or grammar, it could even be one of our guests who answers the final question.
Interesting.
Yeah. Technically, no knowledge of Pali is required for that.
No, that's
step.
Why I
want it.
No, you do actually know a fair number of the words and declensions. Every now and then you give in.
Actually, because it's it reminds me of Latin.
Yeah. I mean, I studied Latin when I was like 8 years old, which might have been why Pali was not too difficult for me.
Yeah, it's... If I'd studied, actually, it would be pretty easy, so I'm kind of thinking that I might actually study it.
Seriously, learning Pali, if you're Buddhist, learning Pali is extremely helpful.
Mm-hmm.
It really is helpful. For one thing, you don't need to chant in both Pali and English, you can just chant in Pali. How awesome is that?
Yeah.
No, I see the value.
Okay. Tunghe samana nang ga tung chivarani pariyesita. This should be very easy. We already know all of these words in one form or another. We've seen every one of them in a previous sentence.
Really?
Uh-huh. Possibly in different forms, but we've seen every one of these words.
What's tunghe?
Does somebody other than her know what tunghe is?
You just learned it.
You plural.
Yes. Correct.
Or y'all.
Okay.
Like that.
This is not Texas. We don't use that word here.
On top of those.
And what's the declension? Yep. Did I talk before about the etymology of the word samana?
No, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. Or at least I don't.
Okay. So samana comes from the root sam, which means peace. So samana is someone who is seeking peace.
Mm-hmm. Who is seeking samana?
Possibly. Another derivation from a different root is from the root, in Sanskrit it's shram. Shram, which means weary. So we see this in Sanskrit Buddhist texts. They crystallized it as shramana. Shramana, which means a world-weary one, someone who's weary of the world. So two different meanings. I prefer the peace seeker. It's a lot nicer than the weary one.
That's compassionate.
Yeah, I'm not weary, but I do seek peace. I'm not weary yet, anyway.
If it were a samaka, it would be one who does peace. Or why isn't it
question?
What's your question?
Translate samana same as renuncia. As shramana. Amanda see shramana translated as renuncia, meaning, you know.
Yeah, I don't
renouncing the world due to weariness.
I don't really like that. For renuncia, I prefer the word pabajito, because that literally means like one who is left behind, one who has left things behind, who has gone away or gone forth from the household life, one who has gone away from sensuality. So I prefer this for renuncia, personally. So shramana, I prefer contemplative. So either in the meaning of peace seeker or world weary, either one, it has, for me, either one pins down the meaning relatively well. Any other questions? Okay, so let's carry on. Datum, what is this word? We know the root, da is give, correct?
To give.
To give, yet tung is the infinitive suffix, so to give. And in fact, here's an easy way to remember that tung means to. So da tung, to, da give. Okay, nice and easy. Just remember that, tung means to. All right.
Mm-hmm.
Chivarani.
Robes,
correct. Karyesata. You've seen this word already as well. No. In fact, I think we've seen it twice already.
Wish.
No. What's the declension?
Die.
Okay. And I should also clarify, pariyesati, the root here, the root here is ace. So pari is a prefix that means completely or thoroughly or all around. So an ace means to look or to search or to seek. So pariyesati is like you're looking all around. So you're really searching. You're not just like looking in one place, you're looking all around. So pariyesata has this broader meaning. Okay? So what does this sentence mean? Tumhe samananang datung chivarani pariyesata.
You plural is like multiverse, you. As
in like you're talking to a group, like you are learning Pali.
So all of you compose.
Yeah.
Is it implied that I give? I give ropes to all of you contemplatives looking, searching for ropes.
Okay. Maybe somebody else can answer this one. No offense. Okay.
I can do it if you want.
Alex?
You search four robes to give to the contemplatives.
Great. Perfect.
What about you search for contemplatives to give robes to?
Well, here again is where word order is useful.
Also, the anan isn't going to be the object of pariyesata.
Yeah, that would be a bit strange. So, pariyesata, we would expect it to have an accusative noun as its object. And the only accusative noun that we have here is chivarani.
Okay. Cool.
Yep. Any questions on that? Okay, let's look at the final sentence and then you'll all be free. Upasako padumani adaya viharam gacchamano buddham disvapasidati.
Disciple Buddha. Church.
Disciple Buddha. Church. Okay, you got the first word right. Now, which word do you think means Buddha, and which word do you think means church? There's no word here that means church. In fact,
church,
even...
monastery,
chapel,
basilica, cathedral.
Oh.
Taken, excellent. And
no
Vihara.
Church.
We will not translate Vihara as church.
Monastery.
Monastery.
Much better. Gacchamano.
I always forget what gacchami means.
Ghost?
Budang sarnang gacchami.
No, but I always forget the gacchami part.
Do you know the sarana part?
Actually, yeah, also that one I forget.
you said goes?
Yes.
Okay, so gachati is goes. So you got the verb
going.
Going, correct.
Oh, I go to the Buddha for refuge.
Oh, that makes sense.
Congratulations, so do I. And Buddhang, what does Buddhang mean?
Lots of Buddhas.
To the Buddha.
No.
Just one, yeah, to the Buddha. Accusative singular, correct. See, you're learning Pali, yay. How about disvaha? We saw this earlier.
Yeah, I remember.
To see?
Close, we know
having
the root.
Having seen.
Having seen, correct. Pasidati. This is what all of us need to do.
Enlightenment?
Is clean.
This is helpful on the way to enlightenment.
Eat?
No. No. Anyone?
I have this, please.
So pasidati, it can mean gains faith or becomes clear. It can mean becomes happy, but faith or clarity is more the meaning of it. So pasidati is like one becomes faithful, or one becomes clear-minded. And it can mean happy, but not really. Is that how it's translated in the book?
Yeah. Probably, because that's
it's
what I
pleased.
Got it from.
Yeah.
So,
I think
is not
sentence.
Pleased
yeah.
with their translation.
I mean, you can translate it joyful, but not really. Faithful or clear-minded is much better.
I can't find it in the book.
Do you know there's a glossary in the back?
I know, I am looking at the glossary.
Well, do you know the order of letters in the Pali alphabet? Well, I think we went over that last week when you were here.
It's on page 47 on the last column.
So it says becomes joyful or
is
something?
Is pleased.
Is pleased.
Oh.
No. 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 The monk is not pleased. Not with that translation. No. Faithful, clear-minded, or possibly joyful, but that's a serious stretch. Okay, let's put this all together. Someone? Anyone?
The disciple becomes faithful, having seen the Buddha.
So, with... you want to start at the beginning with the absolute phrases.
Having taken lotuses and going to the monastery, the disciple becomes faithful, having seen the Buddha.
Okay. I would still recommend putting this first. So, having taken lotuses and going to the monastery, having taken lotuses and having seen them, having seen the Buddha, the Upasika going to the monastery now. Having taken lotuses. The Upasaka who's going to the monastery becomes peaceful having seen the Buddha. Yeah, the way you did it makes the most sense. Yeah.
What about having seen the Buddha who's going to the monastery to...
Unfortunately, no, because Gacchaman, no.
Yeah, they're different declensions. Okay, any questions?
I love the unfortunately no.
Any questions?
Oh, then I'm late to sailing.
Questions? No?
I had a question. What is Sinchitva?
What is what?
I believe it's
this word.
Yeah, I think it's having sprinkled.
That's correct.
Okay. Or possibly
yeah.
Sprayed.
Sprinkled is better, but yeah, it could be sprayed. Yeah, sprinkled is better.
So saranam is for refuge.
Yeah.
Udam saranam gacchami. Okay, cool.
Yep.
and that's an example of I not being stopped at.
Oh, I did have one more question from the homework. If you could do one more sentence, or is that stretching people's patience?
I'm fine.
Do a sentence.
Okay, my question is, do you want to look it up, or I can try and read the sentence?
Where's my primer? Here we go.
But in any case, it's
where is it?
Number 9 in lesson 12.
Number 9 in lesson 12.
Ahang udakang oru ha brahmanasa dusani dawami.
Your pronunciation is not
good.
Awful.
Oh, okay.
No, it's not terrible. I'll give you that. It's better than much that I've heard. Okay, aham udakam oruha brahmanasa dusani dhavami.
I?
Correct. Udakam?
Water.
Water, good. Oruha?
This is the one that confused me.
It's one of the weird ones, because the H and the Y should be switched, right?
Oh, yes!
So it's having
transposition, having
Aruhati.
Oh, is that
Aruhati?
Is that going down?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Aruhati is down.
Yeah.
So like
Aruhati
down. Aruhati up. I don't have an easy way to remember those. Because you think when you're falling down, you'd be yelling, ah! But it's the other way. When you're going up, it's ah.
Okay. Oh! I've fallen.
Like, oh no! Whereas when you're going up, you're like, ah, how peaceful. When you're falling, oh no!
Or when you're falling, it's like, oh no! When you're going up, it's like, ah.
Okay, you can do it that way. Anyway, so oh, Rahati is falling, or descending.
Having
descended.
Good. Brahmanasa.
Of or for the Brahman.
Of for Brahman, good. Dosani.
I have clothes.
Good. Dhavami.
Wash.
What's the declension?
I wash. Me.
Yeah.
Me.
Okay, so putting it all together.
So this is what I don't get. Who's descending? Into the water? Or is the water descending?
Having descended to the water, I wash the Brahman's clothes.
Why is it to the water? It's not locative.
Oh,